Hi, this is Raphael, the creator of Cobalt Strike, and now a technical director over at Help Systems, particularly the cyber threat solutions part of Core Security. And in this video, I'm going to introduce you to Beacon Object Files. Beacon Object Files are a new way in Cobalt Strike 4.1 to write post-exploitation capability that executes in the context of your current beacon session. Let's dig into it. For this demo, we're going to write a little bit of a variant of the MakeToken command. And you may know MakeToken because it takes your current token, creates a copy of it, populated with an alternate set of credentials, and it uses a Win32 API logon user. We're going to use that same API, but instead of creating a copy of our current token, we're going to create a token for the specified username and password. So we're going to create a loser command or logon user. That's what we're going to do to demo the beacon object files. And to make this a fun demo, we're going to kind of write it from scratch together in this video, because I want you to see the full thought process of building a capability and the workflow of working with beacon object files. So let's go ahead and create a folder called loser, and let's jump over there, and we're gonna open up loser.c. And let's include windows.h. We're gonna include beacon.h, which is going to be available for download in the beacon object files documentation. But for now, because I'm cutting this before the release, I'm just gonna copy that over from my little Dropbox. And let's set up the entry point of our beacon object file function, which is going to be the entry point of go. And the arguments it receives are a buffer and a length of the buffer in bytes. So this is our template beacon object file program. All right. Now, I mentioned that we're going to use logon user to take on the take the credentials of a user, of a domain user or local user, and turn that into a token. So let's go ahead and look up the Win32 API for that. And here's our logon user function. And what we're going to do is just populate this. And we're going to actually fill this out with the arguments. We're just going to hard code our arguments for now because we want to just make sure this works. So we got our username, domain, password. We need the logon type and the logon provider. So for logon type, we're going to use logon32, logon interactive. Feel free to experiment with these if you choose to adopt this example. My main goal is a good example here. I don't really know how this would work in production. We're going to use a logon provider. And so we'll use the default one. Why not? Okay. So that's our Win32 API for logon user, nothing to it, right? And if we're writing a capability just to see if this works, we might do something like this. So the function returns true if it's successful and false if it's not. And oh, we forgot an argument. With logon user A, the last argument needs to be a pointer to a token handle. So what we're going to do is just declare a handle. We'll call it htoken. And we're going to use the ampersand or address of operator to pass an address of our token handle from our stack to that function. Okay, looks good. Now, so we've got if this is successful, what to do, and if it's not, what to do. Well, first things we're going to do as well is we're going to close the handle because I do not like handle leaks in my Cobalt Strike capabilities. So we'll do close handle htoken. And ideally, if this is working, we might do success and failure. Or failed, percent D. We'll use get last error. Get last error is a Win32 API to return the reason the last API failed. So there we go. This is a pretty basic little C program. Calls a Win32 API to use the login user function, and we close the handle when we're done. Print success if it works, and if it doesn't, we print out that the result of get last error. So this is not a beacon object file. This is a C program, and it looks pretty close to what our beacon object file will look like, but we need to turn this into the conventions and functions available to a beacon object file. So that's what we're going to do now. So first, there is no printf in beacon object files, but there is beacon printf. And beacon printf is printf, except we have a first parameter, which is callback output, or in this case, callback error. And that's all you need to actually post information to an operator with a beacon object file. So pretty cool. Now here's another thing about beacon object files. A beacon object file is a compiled C program that is not passed to the linker. Cobalt Strike and its beacon payload will act as both the linker and the loader for the beacon object file. Now for this to work, we need to follow a few conventions when we call Win32 APIs. And what we need to do is call the APIs in a way that the library name and function name are both available to our Cobalt Strike instance. So we're going to redeclare logon user, close handle, and get last error in a way that includes a hint with the library information. So let me show you how to do that. What we're going to do is go over to user share. I think it's minimal new for Windows, include. And let's start doing some grepping for logon user or logon user A. And this is the function prototype for logon user A. So let's grab that. And we're going to declare that in our file at the top. And we need to do the same thing for close handle and get last error. So let's look for get last error. Get a lot of stuff back. Let's do space get last error. That's a little bit easier. And let's just grab the function prototype. And you may be asking, why are we doing this? Obviously, these function prototypes are already declared elsewhere, and that's because we're going to modify them slightly, but we want these to be exact as much as possible. I'll explain why in a minute. Let's grab the function prototype for close handle. We'll use my space trick there to narrow that down. And here we go. Win base API, win bool, blah, blah, blah. Perfect. So when we declare a Win32 API for use in a beacon object file, what we want to do is actually do the library name $ the function name. And that library name $ is a hint that Cobalt Strike will use to resolve the right library when trying to run this beacon object file. So let's figure out where each of these live. And over time, you actually might know a lot of them without even looking, but we'll go through the exercise. So logon user A, according to the Microsoft documentation, is in ADV API 32. So let's just go ahead and update this to do ADV API 32 $. And let's look for, in the same way, let's look for get last error. And we will see that this one is indeed in kernel 32. And close handle, I believe, is in kernel 32 as well. And we just scroll to the bottom here, and yeah, that's kernel 32, perfect. Put those in alphabetical order. And now we need to update our code here to do the same thing. So we're gonna just do ADV API, $32. We're gonna do kernel 32, $ close handle, and get last error, we need to do kernel 32, $. There we go. So that's what we need to do to call Win32 APIs from Beacon object files. If you've ever done created a function pointer or declared a function pointer and used get module handle and get proc address to populate that function pointer, that's essentially what we're doing here. It's just done in the background for us by the Beacon object file loader. And of course, DLLs do the same thing. That's what the import table's for, is so that the loader can walk that table, find the functions, and get the right pointers for you. It's very important that when we redeclare these function prototypes, that we get these kind of decorator keywords, such as WinADV API and WinAPI, because these are hints that the compiler will use to generate the right kind of call instruction and to populate the arguments for the function in the right way, depending on the convention that the function expects. So that's why I very much recommend get the original prototype out of the Win32 headers and then just decorate it with the library name like that. All right, cool. So we have a Beacon object file. We are now ready to compile this and try it out in Cobalt Strike. So let's go ahead and open up a new tab. And we're just going to use the GNU cross compiler for Windows to compile this. We could actually use compiler in Visual Studio as well if we want to. But this technique or this implementation is actually pretty compiler agnostic. The main thing is you got to pass the dash C flag here to make sure we get just an object file that's not linked to anything. And there we go. No errors, no warnings. Perfect. Now, you may be wondering about all those conventions, all this dollar sign stuff, right? Like ADV API 32 dollar sign. Why are we doing that? Well, let's take a look at the object file. And we're going to use a tool called Object Dump to do that. So we're going to just do Object Dump. And let's look at all the sections. And we're just going to do loser64.0. And here you can see the sections of our object file. Here we've got the compiled program or executable code. Here are the strings referred to by the executable code, and they're in their own section, our data. And let's do, dash R to see the relocation table. And the relocation records, what these are places in the text section that need to be patched with the right kind of pointer or offset to different parts of these sections and where they live in memory. So references to our data are actually references in our compiled code to the strings in our object file. And Cobalt Strike will, of course, go through these different relocation records and update those references. What's kind of cool is nothing needs to be contiguous. Like, we don't have to have the code and our strings in the same region of memory. They can be in different regions. Now, when it comes to importing functions that exist elsewhere in other libraries, you can see why it's kind of handy that we adopted that dollar sign convention, because here, Cobalt Strike just has to parse out these function calls and say, you want to call kernel 32 close handle here. I will find where that is. And when walking through these relocation records, I will patch that right function record, or in this case, is actually a pointer to the function. I'll patch that into the right spot. And for internal stuff like Beacon Printf, same thing. Cobalt Strike knows about Beacon Printf. It's an internal API, so it knows just to patch in that pointer, which actually points to Beacon Printf into the right spot. So that's what's going on with Beacon object files. This is why we've got this kind of funny convention for prefixing the library. If we didn't have that, we'd have to have a whole scheme of declaring what's in a library and some sort of means of passing the library information to Cobalt Strike when you run your Beacon object file. And this seemed like kind of a cleaner way to be something that was compiler agnostic. So that's why we do it this way. All right, so we've got a Beacon object file. Let's try it out in Cobalt Strike. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna run inline execute, and that is a function that will run a Beacon object file. And we're just gonna tab complete over to our loser file and see what Cobalt Strike does with it. And it looks like success, it worked. Cool. All right, that's helpful. So it was able to call that API, it didn't fail, and it closed that handle. Perfect. Now, let's do a little bit more to this. Let's just try to force it to fail. Let's change that hard-coded password. And let's recompile our Beacon object file. And let's try that again. And we get a failure. We get error code 1326. And if we do net help message 1326, we will see that the username or password is incorrect. And that makes sense for a failure condition, right? Cool. So what I hope you're getting is some confidence that this little structure of a program we've written is kind of correct. But there's a lot to do before this is really going to be something that we can use. First, we have a token we've generated, and it's here in this htoken handle, but we haven't done anything with it. And that's what I want to do now. Let's go ahead and have Beacon take on this token. And we can do that by jumping over to the Beacon object file documentation, go way to the bottom here. And what I want you to see is that there's internal APIs. For example, one to use a token that we obtained, possibly through a privilege escalation exploit implemented as a BOF. So we're just gonna do Beacon use token, and that will have Beacon take on this token. And Beacon use token will actually print a message to our user if it worked, and it'll print something if it didn't. So I don't think we really need to do anything more here. So we're gonna get rid of our success message, and we're gonna use the Beacon use token internal API. Let's recompile that, and let's try that out. And what you're going to see here is actually we don't get any output back. That is probably because we took on this token, and that's great for us, but we actually can't query the token because it's a higher privilege token, and we're in an unprivileged context. So just Windows tokens get funny like that, especially from an unprivileged context. So let me just try to run a command like arp-a. We should get an error because of our token. So let's do rev2self. And let's go ahead and try this out from a privilege context where I believe we'll have a little bit more luck. So here we're in a system context, and it may be a little more useful here to be able to create a token within the current process as a user in the current system. So what we're going to do is run our loser file. And there you go. You can see we've impersonated the corp administrator user. And if we do get UID, we're corp administrator. If we run who am I, we will see that we are corp administrator. And if we drop the token with rev2self and we do get UID, we will see that we are system. Just waiting for a check-in. There you go. So that's cool. So what we've gotten a hint of is that, maybe we need some guardrails for this capability because it's not going to be so useful to us from an unprivileged context. No big deal. So we're going to use another internal Beacon API, and that is Beacon is admin to determine if our payload is in a high integrity context or not when we're running the capability. So let's come over here and we're just going to update this and add our guardrail. So let's do if beacon is admin, or excuse me, if beacon is not admin, we're going to do beacon printf callback error and say you must be admin to use this. Let's return and let's compile that and let's try it out from our low privilege context. And you can see that our guardrail worked there. And if we come over here, try it out, we will see it worked as expected. Great. So this is cool. What I hope you're seeing and appreciating is kind of the quick feedback loop between trying something out, compiling, and or making a code change, compiling, and trying it out in Cobalt Strike. Very, very fast feedback loop here. So that makes this a really kind of cool capability for just prototyping things, trying them out. All right, great. So we've got our guardrail. Now, what do we want to do next? I think the next logical step is to actually move away from having hard-coded arguments, right? Like we don't want to have to recompile our loser file every time we want to try out a different set of credentials. So that's a good segue for actually trying to set this up with an aggressor script to be run via Cobalt Strike's scripting language. So we've got our work cut out for us. So let's come over to the loser folder. Let's create a loser.cna script. We'll create an alias loser. And just kind of give you an idea, when you create an alias in Cobalt Strike, $1 is always the beacon ID. And with the aliases, they're separated by space. So we'll have $2 be the domain user, and $3 is going to be the password. Works for me. All right, so let's go ahead and set this up. So first things first, we want to set up this alias to read in our beacon object file. And we're going to just do openf script resource, and we're going to reference loser.x64.o. Just going to read that in. The reason we're reading this in is because the Cobalt Strike API that runs bot files expects to receive the bot file as a byte array. And the reason I don't have a specify a file is because I want to leave you the option to, if you want to base64 encode the, to base64 encode the file and embed it directly into your script. They're not that big. So that's really up to you. That's kind of a style choice. But for here, we're just going to reference the loser x64.o file. So say read in our bot file. Now the aggressor script function to run a bot is beacon inline execute. And what we have to give it is our beacon ID, the actual bot file. And we have to give it the function to call. And this is handy because it gives us the option to embed multiple pieces of functionality into one bot file. We're going to stick with Go because that is the default for the inline execute command. But I want you to know you have the option. The next thing we need to do is provide our arguments to beacon inline execute. And here's how we're going to do that. We're going to use a function called boff pack. So we're going to pack our arguments. Here's how that works. We're going to do args equals boff pack. And boff pack accepts our beacon ID as its first parameter, and then it accepts a format string. And what we're going to give it is null terminated strings, null terminated 8-bit strings. So we're going to do z, 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 z. Each of those is a 0-byte or null terminated ASCII string. And we're going to give it the domain, the username, and the password. And what's going to happen here is aggressor script is going to take each of these parameters. It's going to add a null terminator to it. And it's going to convert it from Java's internal UTF-16 encoding to the platform encoding of this beacon session. That's why we have to provide the beacon session. So this is part of how Cobalt Strike handles Unicode is you can pass UTF-16 things if you want to. That would actually be an uppercase Z if we wanted to do that. But if you don't do that, Cobalt Strike will transparently, or I guess semi-transparently, because you have to be explicit that you want it done, it will convert your arguments to the encoding of the target session. So that's something that kind of happens in the background there. And so boff pack takes care of that. So now we've got our arguments, and that's our beacon inline execute. Now what we need to do is actually parse out our username, domain, user, and password. So let's do domain, user, pass, parse our arguments. So domain, user equals split. And one of the things I always get confused by with split, we're just doing that $2, and pass is going to be, we'll just be assigned $3. One of the things I get confused by with split is when dealing with backslashes, it becomes kind of a special case. So let's try something out. Let's go to View Script Console in Cobalt Strike, and let's do X split. And let's do domain user. And that's why I'm trying this out, because that tends to fail. Let's do 4 backslashes and things split like I would expect. Okay, cool. So we're going to do 4 backslashes in split because we're dealing with the fact that backslash is an escape character inside of our double quotes, but it's also an escape character inside of regexes. That's confusing. Okay, cool. So now we've got our arguments split up, domain, and just noticed forgot a dollar sigil there. So domain user pass. So all of that looks good. A couple other things I want to do here, very small things. When we use beacon inline execute, it doesn't actually announce anything to our user. So we want to use btask to do that. So we're going to say create token as $2. And the last thing I want to do is I just want to add a number of arguments checks. We're going to look at the size of @_, which happens to have all of our arguments. And if that is not equal to 3, what we're going to do is beer or beacon error, not enough loser, not enough arguments. Let's return. So that's what it looks like to, in a healthy way, integrate a capability via aggressor script. Checking our arguments, parsing out our arguments, reading in the boff file, the beacon object file, packing the arguments, announcing things, and then running the boff. That's it. Okay. Now let's go ahead and load this into Cobalt Strike. Let's do load /loser, loser.cna, and that will give us our loser function. If we just run it, we're getting back the expected not enough arguments error. Perfect. Now, let's read these arguments or parse them via our beacon object file. So when you send arguments to a beacon object file, especially packed arguments, those are going to be made available here in our function prototype, which is just a pointer to a character buffer and a length value. Now you may be asking, how do I parse out those arguments? Well, there's an internal API to do it, and I really recommend that you use this API because it's thought out, it works, and it's going to save you a lot of headaches. In fact, it's pretty easy to extract our arguments. And we're going to use the Beacon Data Parser API, and that's documented here. But let's go ahead and just take a look at using this. So what we're going to do is declare a data parser object on the stack, which is very small, and it's uninitialized. And we're going to initialize it with the beacon data parse function. And we're going to pass it the address of our parser. And we're going to initialize our parser with this buffer and this length. Now let's go ahead and declare our domain, our user, and our password as pointers, and let's extract them. So to get the domain out of our parser, we're just going to do this. Domain equals beacon data extract. Going to pass it a pointer to our parser. And if we want to, we can give it a, as a second argument, the address of a integer to populate with the size of our domain value. But really, we can just do domain user pass. So we don't really care about the length. They're already zero terminated for us because buff pack took care of that. And beacon data extract will go ahead and pull all of these out of that buffer for us. So everything will work out just fine. And that's it. That's all it takes to extract arguments packed with buff pack. And let's go ahead and populate these into our buff file. So let's see, our user, domain, pass. Looks good to me. Now let's go ahead and compile this. There we go. Looks good. One thing I want to point out, when we use beacon data extract, this function is actually operating on our buffer and returning a pointer within it. So you don't have to worry about freeing anything here because that's already kind of being managed for you by beacon in the background. Data parser being on the stack, that's taken care of when our function exits. And it is a very small structure. And we're not doing anything to create any new memory or allocate memory that's got to be freed here. So I just want to point that out. All right, so we compiled this. So now in theory, we've got a buff file and a script that passes arguments and a buff file that uses those arguments. So let's go ahead and try that out. Let's hop over to our system beacon. And let's do loser. Let's do get UID just to prove that there's nothing crazy going on. And we're going to do loser. Let's do a different user. We'll do somebody that's actually not an administrator. Let's do what a hog. I use that in a lot of my demos. Governess 1234 bang. And there we go. We now have a token for the user what a hog. And we can do things as what a hog from our previously system context. Pretty cool, right? Now, one last thing I want to do just for kind of good measure, and that's to compile this as a 32-bit buff, and we're just about ready to conclude the demo. We're almost done. All right, next thing we're going to do is just use the 32-bit compiler, and we're just going to create a 32-bit loser file. No warnings, no errors, great. And what we're going to do is jump over to our aggressor script, and we're gonna just do this. We're gonna query the architecture of this beacon file, and we're gonna use the the bark function to do that. That's going to return x86 or x64. And we're just going to replace the file name with that architecture value. And let's reload our script, reload loser.cna. And let's try this out. So we're going to just drop our token here, and we're just going to verify it still works 64-bit. We'll give it the right password. Actually, let's just give it the wrong one. We want to see an error. I think that would be useful. Just to verify everything's working, cool. Now, let's go ahead and spawn a 32-bit beacon session at system. And let's try out our loser alias here. And let's do, we'll do administrator, why not? Let me just do a get UID to prove to you that I am not administrator. And we're gonna do loser corp administrator, password 1234 bang. We'll do a get UID just to prove that it worked. And that's our 32-bit context. And there you go. So in this video, I've taken you through beacon object files, and we developed one together end to end. We started out with a capability. We kind of mocked it up in C without any beacon object file conventions. We then applied the beacon object file conventions. That's things like declaring the function prototypes, prefixing the library information followed by dollar sign. We used the appropriate beacon APIs for output and some of the internal APIs to change the state of the beacon. We then demonstrated how to integrate the capability with aggressor script and how to pack multiple arguments to be passed to the beacon object file and how to extract those arguments in C. Again, nothing too bad. If you're doing pointer arithmetic here, you're doing it wrong. There's a nice API for it. And just kind of walk through how to make this work and how to really make this kind of a full-fledged, ready-to-use capability. So that's my demonstration of beacon object files, a new capability and a new way to write post-exploitation capability in Cobalt Strike 4.1. I hope you enjoyed this video. Good luck and happy hacking.